Dr. V. Kartika is an assistant professor of English in the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences at the National Institute of Technology, Tiruchirappalli, commonly known as NIT Trichy. Before joining to this university, she worked as an assistant professor at the Department of English in VIT, Andhra Pradesh University, Amaravati. She worked in England as an ESOL instructor and assessor for ESOL examinations for 4 years. She offers lectures and sessions on aviation English, Airport Authority of India, translations and critical discourse analysis, National Translation Mission, public speaking skill, MCRHRD, Institutes of Telangana, etc. She has published papers in journals of national and international repute. Dr. V. Kartika currently researches in the field of aviation English and develops materials for training in aeronautical communication. Her research interests also situate in the areas of English medium instruction, cultural studies, translation studies. So with this brief introduction, may I invite Dr. Kartika to deliver the lecture.
Good morning. Thank you very much. You have given me a very formal introduction. Thank you, Adafro Madam. Thank you, Sumangra Ma'am. Nice to see you. And I'm really glad that Tariq Ji has given me this opportunity. I thank him as well at the outset. So without much ado, let me just move into my presentation. And just one word to the participants. In case if I experience any technical difficulty, I'll come back. But hopefully nothing of that sort. Let me just see if I can share the screen. Is that visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Yeah, if I make it full screen, in all probability, usually Google Form gives me, Google gives me trouble in moving the slides, but still I'll try. I'll make it full screen, and if it doesn't move, please let me know so that I will just minimize and will continue. Okay. So see, if you look at the title itself, you can see a small little bit of concern there. Introducing critical discourse analysis, reconceptualization and ideology. Actually, this is about translation studies, and probably this would have been a better fit towards the end of this 2 weeks program. However, because of so many pragmatic reasons, this is scheduled today. So it will be a little early for you to walk through this, but I'm sure that you can cope with it. There is nothing like rocket science that I'm going to discuss. It's all about translation, ideology, reconceptualization, and critical discourse analysis. So it's all going to be good. And please don't anticipate that you will be able to translate immediately after this session. Nobody can promise you that. I'm moving my slide now. Please let me know if it is visible. Can you see that? The second slide? Or am I still on the first slide?
Still on the first slide. On the first slide, ma'am.
This is what I'll just make it short, the smaller version. What I'll do, I'll come back. We'll start sharing the screen again. Yeah, the Google Meet always gives me this trouble. No problem. I hope things are pretty legible for you. So this is the plan for today. I'll be just briefly discussing what is critical discourse analysis. Many of you might know. Still, we'll just revisit a few concerns and concepts. And why is critical discourse analysis important at all? And how is it important in translation studies? Well, I talk about translation studies here. However, we are not just limiting it to the research in translations, but while we go through it, we also look at the possibility of how being informed about critical discourse analysis, reconceptualization, and other related concepts, how can they assist us to be better translators? Okay, so I'm not going to spoon-feed anything. I hope you will be able to read between the lines and will use it as a starting point to go forward in this area of translation. I'm moving the slide. Yes, so critical discourse analysis, let's just look at it. It's critical because it's an examination of the merits in the sense I'm not asking you to think through the lines of good or bad text, but we will be close examining the text for its merits and for its faults. Okay, and discourse, it can be written, spoken, anything. It can be, the text could be anything. It could be a dialogue. It could be a WhatsApp message. In fact, I wanted to give you an activity, because of various reasons, and this 1 hour is a limitation. If I had like 1.5 hours, I would have definitely given you this. Perhaps at the end of it, I can send it to you. It's a small WhatsApp message that I want you to translate without knowing the context, and then after knowing the context. But I couldn't do that before the session. I didn't want to destroy your Sunday, and then this 1 hour is really limited. Therefore, maybe later you can think through it once you get the content with you. Yes, discourse, as I told you, written, spoken, it can be visual, it can be auditory, anything. And analysis, because we'll be trying to explain the elements of the structure of a text. And the structure is a very curious word. I'll come back to that. So basically, this is critical discourse analysis. I know it is a very bare minimum kind of description. So let's go detail a bit. If the analysis of text, no doubt in that, whatever kind of text, we analyze it. And why do we analyze it? We analyze it to give visibility to the ideological heaviness or the lording of ways of language used to construct power relations. So we need to understand that language is a tool to actually project power. Think about it. I always use that phrase a lot in my speeches. So you need to really think about it. How is language a way of using or, implanting power or just implementing power? How is it a medium of conveying power to another person? So you look at various things, you are late. Okay, if somebody says that you are late. Oh, I'm worried you are late. That is another way of saying the same thing. Your lateness really annoys me. So you use the same idea in three different ways with different semantic or different linguistic features. Okay, you use it together, and then each one carries almost the same meaning, but it also conveys something else as well. So this just one very simple example. We'll go to more complex ones soon. I wanted to give you more and more examples as well, but again, I'm telling you, time is a constraint. So I'll be quickly walking you through this, and then this is food for thought. You can think about this bit that I'm telling you, and then see how you can implement or how you can use this theory to support your translations in a better way. I'm sure you people are going to translate. So when you do that, how can you use it as a background or background theory with which you can actually make the translations in a slightly better way or a little a political kind of way. So as I told you, there should be some ideological loading in every single text. And then you are unpacking it and you are seeing how it is going to be, just 1 second. So viewing text as products in social, political, and cultural context. This is another aspect of critical discourse analysis. we take text as products in social, political, and cultural context. This, I think the other day somebody has spoken about this, and you will be hearing a lot about this cultural aspects of translations and all. So one aspect of CDA or critical discourse analysis is viewing these texts as the social product or political product or cultural product situated within that context. Okay. Now, it also says that a text can reinforce, okay, subvert and modify the existing social order. Please think about it. A text can reinforce, subvert, and modify the social order. Can you think about an example for this? Can somebody give me an example for this? A text. It can be a film. It can be a song. It can be anything. that can actually either reinforce or subvert or perhaps modify the existing social order. Can you think about an example from your own language, from your own context? Are you with me? Yes, I can see people here.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
I will put forth an example that is the book by Franz Fanon.
Okay.
That is the Richard of Richard of the Earth.
Okay, tell me. What about that? How does it subvert or how does it reinforce something?
Yes. After reading that book, one who goes through that book definitely gets an idea of opposition to the term decolonization. Means we are getting aware of the sense of.
All right. Okay. So these are from masters, right? Can we think about? Thank you for the answer. I mean, thank you for responding. Thank you very much. Can we think about something more personal, something more related to our own context? See, I can give you examples from my own place, but then I was thinking if you can come out. I know that there are people from Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, West Bengal, Orissa. So there are different. The whole India is here. So can somebody tell me from your own context one example of a text being so powerful in changing the existing social order? A slight change at least. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you?
Yeah, I can give you an example. For example, as you have been saying, changing the social order completely. So a text, for example, Animal Farm is translated into Gujarati language. So the Animal Farm has been completely modified in a Gujarati language in a different sense by changing the entire characters, locations, as well as the chapter's name. So the social order of the source text was completely different to that of the target language, because here the translator completely denied the entire context as well as the structure of the source text and modifying it in the target language. So the characters in the Gujarati language are completely different to that of Animal Farm's original character. So that can be an example.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, that's again going back to the literary text. I was more inclined to know whether you understood this concept of critical discourse analysis, because you think about. Yeah, thank you very much for that. Good example. Both of them were good examples. Thank you very much. Now you may be muted. Thank you. I'll continue. So think about these political pamphlets, or think about the speeches. You know, there are people who say that one speech and it changed the complete election plan. You think about it in that way. That is also a text. And if we do a critical discourse, yes, look at that. Kedar Joshi is giving Dr. Ambedkar's book. There are things that actually make us think through things and then make changes. Okay, so if you look at several things, several discourses in our society, some of the legal legal documents or some of the verdicts, these are all part of the discourse. You know, that is part of the legal discourse, and it can have a kind of impact upon the existing judiciary system and the new bills that are going to be in place. Look at NEP or National Education Policy. All these things are part of discourse, and when something like that happens or come into implementation, it can have a difference, or it can actually modify the existing social order. Simply take it that simply. Okay. So now, yes, there are so many things about caste, religion, and then as I told you about various verdicts coming from the Supreme Court, things like that, part of constitution, changes like that. Okay, let me just take you back because I need to finish the chapter as well. Yeah, so a text can actually reinforce, subvert, and modify the social order. I would really love it if you would take some time this evening to think about it, because this can really help you in being good writers and also being good readers, also in being good translators. I'll tell you how that in a while. So relationship between text and the social world, okay, the world around it, is mediated by the way in which the text combines or articulate different discourses, genres, and styles. So I'll be basing my arguments on what Fairclough has mentioned. So it's about the domination, it's about the power of language, and it's about the domination that is parceled and trafficked through language. Fine. So the text and the social world, and how is it related, and how is it related through or how is it connected with each other through different discourses, different genres, and different styles. This is about critical discourse analysis. Let me show you the three dimensions of critical discourse analysis. You look at it, the crux is the text, okay, the dimension one, the single dimension, that is text, whatever it is, a film, a song, a poster, or a text, or a novel, or a poem, whatever it is, that is the text. And when you look at the text, if you look at the next diagram, you can see that it's the description. There are three levels of things going on: description, interpretation, and explanation of the text. I'm not yet reaching the translation. I'm telling you about the text, and then we will move to how this is related to translation. So please bear with me. We will think about the description part, interpretation part, and the explanation bit of it in the framework of critical discourse analysis. So when a text is produced, and when you have to analyze it, we go for the first layer of analysis, which is the textual analysis. You'll be looking at the grammatical features, you'll be looking at the vocabulary, the lexical complexities, all those things at that word level. So it's an analysis. You will hold the lens and you will look at the verbal bit of it. You will study the text as a combination of different linguistic devices. All right. And that level of interpretation is textual analysis, and that stays there in the first dimension. When you move to the second dimension, you have something called discursive practice or discourse practice. That is where the interaction happens. Discourse, we know, it's like now we are having a discourse, right? I'm talking to you, you are listening to me, and at times you talk back to me. Even if you are not talking to me, you might be putting something in the chat box. So my modality will be speaking, your modality in engaging in the discourse will be typing, or you might be thinking. There are various levels of discourse that is going on right now. Similarly, when a book is produced, okay, it's a little different and it's a little challenging. When a book is produced, this type of an analysis or discursive practice is all about the processing. How is the book being received? How is the book being published? And how is it being received within that dimension? So we will be looking at one book is produced, and what is its receptibility? What is its acceptability? How was the production bit of it? Such processing part will be there, and then the interpretation happens between them both. The textual analysis plus the discursive practice together gives us an interpretation. Okay, these are the implications of this book being published. Okay, that level ends there. So it's the text production and the consumption by the readership. All right. Now, the last level is, or the last dimension is social practice. So when you come to the social practice, or perhaps socio-cultural practice, that yields the explanation that we talked about in the first few slides, the explanation part of the text. And how is it being explained? It's a conglomeration of discourse practice and socio-cultural practice together. Okay, we discussed that, we explained that, what are the social factors that contributed to the productions of the text, or what are the factors that contributed to the rejection of the text. You think about it, okay? There was a text called Amen, okay, which was written by a nun who left the left the convent, and she came out of the congregation and she proclaimed her independence as a woman, and she talked against the practices that were existing in the convent. A pretty strong kind of an objection. And when you look at that particular text, okay, its translation is done in English. That is what I said. It's called Amen. And when you look at it, you can see that it is actually challenging a lot of socio-cultural practices or religious practices that are existing, and questioning so many things about gender discourse, talking about the male chauvinism that is prevalent in the religious segment as well. A particular community is being questioned for their practices. So many things. Sexuality is being questioned. There are so many aspects, so many layers to this kind of discourse. At the same time, at the discursive level or the second dimension, how was this book received? Obviously, this has positive and negative kind of impact, and even negative publicity resulted in higher copies being printed out and people buying it and reading it. Negative publicity is another thing. So what constituted this negative publicity, and what kind of audience reaction or readership reactions contributed to this? So there are a lot of things, and one is not different from the other. Okay, people have to, I mean, we have to, being critics, we have to analyze all these three layers. The text cannot be just dismissed. The textual analysis have to be carried out. I mean, has to be carried out, and then move to the discursive practice, and then come to the socio-cultural practice. Everything is interrelated. Only then you will get the description bit, interpretation bit, and explanation bit clearly. So understand that you will analyze the text. When you get a text to read, you will first analyze it in the linguistic terms, and somewhere in your head you will be connecting it with the socio-cultural aspects of it as well. And that is how we become literary critics and all. And why is it important? I'll tell you. Okay, why is critical discourse analysis so critical? Why is it so important? Because it shows non-obvious ways in which language is involved in social relations of power and domination. I told you, language is very powerful. Okay, it's very powerful. The way you use language is very powerful. And in speaking, you have it manifested in different ways, but in writing, it gets manifested in different ways. The authorial intention, the author's intention. And think about it. If you don't, as a translator, if you don't capture the author's intention, how are you going to manage that translation in a faithful way? We talk about faithful translations. Then if you don't understand that author's perspective or the author's ideology, how are you going to manage that in your translation, manage faithfulness in your translation? Think about it. So we need to understand how power constructions are being made, or how power and domination are constructs that are being made within the domain of language, within a text. How is it situated within a text? And for that, let's ask four questions to ourselves when we read something. What does society value or dismiss in terms of this particular text? Okay. Think about the Colgate advertisement. I'm sure you must have seen it. The smile one. No, not Colgate. Close up. Close up has always got that close kind of pictures. I used to show a few videos, but then I know that we don't have time and it may get stuck in between and all. Perhaps I can send you the links later along with the PowerPoint slide. So if you want, you can watch it. And think through this way. Thinking is very important, okay? You can listen to this endlessly and then just leave it there. That is one way of attending programs like this. But then if you want to learn something, you need to really start thinking from here and proceed with the thinking. It should never stop. So I shall send you the links. But if anybody remembers this close-up ad where they celebrate diversity and inclusivity, the same-sex marriage or the same-sex couple coming together, and then the caste problem, all those things. One person was a Brahmin and the other one was from a different caste. They couldn't unite and they're meeting after so many days. It's a cooked-up kind of thing, but then still the emotions they portray, the questions that they raise, and then we watch it and we, perfect, fantastic, we say that. But look at the time of its production. We read the text as such. Okay, this is close-up advertisement. There are couples coming together, and some of them are same-sex couple, and some of them are like different caste people, and some of them, mostly women, don't have freedom of choice. We understand all of those in the second dimension as well. And how is it received? It got well received, actually. The public really applauded for that. But then when you come to the social dimension, when was this produced? You think about it. And why was this particular ad produced at that point of time? Can somebody guess? If this type of an advertisement came out, what time or what context in India it would have come out?
During the Pride Act, ma'am, during the Pride, when the government recognized gay marriage, making it legal. Yes.
What was that article? One article was
370.
Yes. 370. Right. It is during that time this advertisement came out. So does it have any implication? You think about it. It has, because so far they could have come up with the same kind of advertisements many times, but they needed a strong ground to base their advertisement. And now nobody can challenge them because the government has passed the law. The law is passed, so they can actually go for it, no problem. So have you seen the social context or the political or judicial context being very very much interpolating into the making of an advertisement, which is totally, which is like largely consumed by the audience? And people keep on thinking, and we praise such kind of advertisements as path breaking and this, that, and all. I'm not criticizing it. Somewhere we have to have such sort of different ways of thinking and all. And now you can see that transgenders are more and more coming into the TVs and channels and shows and all those things because of a change kind of mindset. And because of social media, unedited kind of expression freedom, there are so many things happening. And then all of them, if you look at as literary texts, we have something to say about the context and how that verbal part is related to the context. You know, the daring feeling to express things, or maybe, the comfortability in expressing things. How is it related to the social context that it is being expressed? Okay, so you can think about it, even about this hashtag MeToo movement. If you think about it, you will understand how that is actually placed within the cultural or within the context. Because there is a predecessor or precursor for that, all of a sudden something started. I'm not against that, okay? Not against that. I'm telling you that there is always something in the society that provokes something else. And then it gets manifested through language, and very strong language, very dominant ideology is being projected. We need to think through it. So what does society value or dismiss in terms of this text? What does the author value or dismiss? Are they same or are they different? Big question, billion-dollar question. What biases are presented in the text, and what are the implications? Are there biases in the text, And then who is presented as powerful in the text, and what are the implications of it? We can read things differently, right? One common example that everybody who deals with critical discourse analysis, I caught one of them actually, gives us about somebody being called as a patriot, okay? A patriot. And what's the difference between a patriot and an extremist? Or what is the difference between a patriot and a terrorist? Okay, and capital punishment and death sentence. So if I say that he was given death sentence, what do you understand about my attitude towards death sentence? If I prefer, I'm a writer and I prefer the word death sentence to capital punishment, you need to understand that I'm against that. Okay, capital punishment is a romanticized concept of the same thing. So when I say that capital punishment, it shows that I'm either neutral or more than neutral. I'm actually pro to this concept of capital punishment. So this is how language actually carries our ideologies, attitudes, and it becomes so powerful in explaining things. Okay. So I'll move on because we have to finish quite a bit. I'm halfway through the time. Yes. Now, let's think about these three sentences. The first three sentences. Okay. Protesters shot by police. Okay. Second sentence, same concept in three different newspapers. Police shoots protesters. The third one, the rubber bullets fired to control the situation killed many protesters. Can you think about it? Can you comment on these three sentences? What is so critical about them? What is being true and what is being not? Okay, I'll give you an example before I open this question up to you. I was a 5-year-old girl and my mom left me. She was a professor, so she had to go to university. And I was like, I didn't have school that day, so I was alone at home. And we had a beautiful crystal flower vase. I used to love it and I used to play with it. But my mom said, see, I'm going and you shouldn't take it. It will break. You can't hold it. It will break. She repeatedly warned me and she went. And of course, me being me, I took it, played with it and it broke. I was careless and I couldn't handle that. It broke. And I started thinking about it. My goodness, what will happen to me? Okay. This experience is common to everyone. If not flower vase, you must have broken something else and you must have gone through the same kind of feeling. Now, you may not be able to recollect that, but just listen to me. She came back and then I said, the flower vase is broken. I didn't say I broke the flower vase, though it was the truth. I said the flower vase is broken. And what did I do? I was a 5-year-old child. I didn't know the nuances of language. Definitely not about I didn't know that I was using passive voice. But I knew that I had to know. I mean, I shouldn't tell her that I broke it. The agent, the subject shouldn't be there. And I knew something like, okay, some other way to put it. This is with everyone. Everyone has that capability. Now I see that my daughter doing it, you know, hiding the agent, hiding the subject and saying things when she fears punishment. So we have all that thing in our mind. So here is a case of using passive voice. And why do we use passive voice here? In the first sentence, passive voice is used. Protesters shot by police. There is a need to just diminish the importance of police shooting them. Diminish the gravity of the atrocity that is infested upon or inflicted upon the protesters. Therefore, there is a very, very nuanced kind of use of passive voice in the first sentence. The second one, the agent is more evident. Police shoots protesters. Okay. And police is always part of the ruling party. Think about it that the ruling government, the government who rules. They own the police. Okay, I'm using a very different word. Okay, on is a very different word, but then yeah, take it. In that case, which of these three ones do you think, you can put it in the chat box, the first, second or third, which is more pro towards the government and which is more anti towards the government? Can you tell me? First, let's go for the pro one. Let me see. 1, 2, 3. 3 is more pro. No, remember it. More pro in the sense. Yeah. See, pro in the sense it's supporting. Is the third one supporting the government?
Madam, it is rubber bullets fired to control the situation killed many protesters.
That is. Anti-government one, yes. So that is against the, you know, if we consider police as a part of the system, then it's anti-system statement, the last one. And the first one is more pro towards the government because they're trying to hide that important bit of it. And then the second one is like a clear statement. Okay, this is done. Okay, and somebody has given it a very interesting kind of comment here. Hiding the reasons, Prashant Kumar has written, hiding the reasons behind it, the reason of shooting. Hiding the active participant. Yes, so you have answered. Khalid has said political and social slogans in present and past also. Yes, that is where I'm going to come, Mr. Khalid. Thank you very much for that. I missed these chat box interactions. Sorry about that. Promoting it in such a way that accusations come up. Exactly. Yes, that is how it was. So, don't we see that, you know, I had some other interesting examples as well during the demonetization times. I didn't bring it today because too many examples. I dwell in examples and it will take all the time. So I just limited it. This ATM, the man, old man dies on his way to ATM. And then there are different newspapers portraying the news in different ways. And we know that the media journalism, you know, how the journalistic writing is coming through these days. And if you read the newspaper every single day, you will understand, you know, a lot of possibility of critical discourse analysis being there. Somebody has unmuted the mic. Could you please be muted if you are not talking to me? Because it gives me some echoing or thank you very much. Yeah, now you look at the last one. This is this example is a little different from the previous one. Seeking, you can read it, 25 to 40, well-placed animal loving vegetarian groom for my son who works with an NGO, cast no bar, though higher preferred. Any comments on this? Anything that strikes you? You can put it in the chat box. Anything that you have noticed? It's an ad for a gay marriage. Yes, true. So we should think that gay marriage and it being advertised in a newspaper this is from a newspaper, okay, from a very leading newspaper. So that is very progressive. So is it, will you call this advertisement as progressive? Yes, Ishika says yes. I don't know whether you are a doctor, Miss, Mrs. So I'm just taking the name plainly. Okay, don't feel bad. The last statement making it clear that they are biased towards IR and quite evident that they are focusing on gay marriage. Okay, progressive. It shows an acceptance of the parent who accepts. Okay, very good, Sanjeev. Yes, so Ishika reiterates that it's progressive. So what about what Prashant said? What about the last though? You know, you can see that word though, just a single word, isn't it? Though caste is not a problem, though one single word, and that actually disrupts the entire construction of that discourse, doesn't it? If we take it as a discourse where a mother is actually, this is a mother, okay, Miss Padma Iyer. She is the mother of a Mumbai-based activist whose name is Harish Iyer. He is a gay activist. Okay, so she advertised for his marriage. So now, it's a beautiful construction, isn't it? It's a beautiful discourse. A lot of acceptance. The parent is accepting. Fantastic. But then, when it comes to that though part, there was a wild discussion going on. Lot of discussions. If you just go through this link, you will be able to read one such article which discusses various aspects of this issue. I'm not going to comment on it critically now, but I'm just, as I told you, giving it as a food for thought. Think about it. So one single word has actually tilted everything that we have read so far. So how critical is what we read? You know, how critical or how important it is to understand and to process it through different layers, analyze it, evaluate it, make judgments over it when we read something. If you just not look at that though carefully, and then if you stop with the though, and then if you think that, okay, she has said so many things, and then though she said, so it's all about not so progressive. You can't dismiss it. There is still a clear case of being progressive there. And then why is this though being there? And then if you think about it, you have a lot of philosophical questions to ponder about. I'll send you the PowerPoint. They'll share it with you. And then you can go through this link and read that Hindu article on this. Okay. Now, let me move on. I am from Kerala and I couldn't just stop sharing this this bit. Okay. This is like, I know that you can't read it, but you can see the picture. Okay. When you see the picture, I really appreciate if somebody from some other language background, some other state of India other than Kerala, respond to this. Can you tell me what is this context? Simple, very simple. Please put it in the chat box.
It is a marriage going on, I think.
Yes, it's a marriage because you have so many... Okay, Vastradan to the bride, marriage ceremony, that is right, yes. You are completely true. So that is the context. And you know what you can see here down there towards that line, you can see something written there. That's called advertisement. So this is an advertisement. Okay. And it's written, the bold one is written as marriage or wedding, whatever. I'll tell you what is written in that. You can just go through it. Please read it because I don't want to read through everything. So this is the marriage of marriage that happens in a particular caste, which is considered as a very prestigious ones in Kerala. Don't think that these are all my subscriptions, okay? this is very interesting for critical discourse analysis, and that is why I just couldn't just leave it there. Okay, so the bride is known as Maithili Menon, and she is of the bloodline of, this is kind of a translation of the same thing, okay? Bloodline of Diwan Peshkar, whoever, of Travancore. Okay, look at that. Tiruvidankur is written, that is the Malayalam word for it, but then again they translated it into the English name, not translated, they put the English name as well, Travancore, and Srimati Gauri Amma. But think about it all, this is coming in a Malayalam daily, okay? They don't have to write Travancore there, first of all. I mean, not first of all, it, one of the things that I noticed. This is followed by an introduction to her mother, okay? So the bloodline of somebody, great-great-great-grandfather is written there. And then the mother, IAAS Mahalakshmi Menon, Principal General Accountant, Father Krishna Menon. Look at the placement, mother first, father second, there is no problem. I'm not an anti-feminist or anything. Working in Geneva with the UN, very important. The groom was introduced as Nakul Prasad, who belonged to a respected Nair caste family, whose father, so-and-so, Chief General Manager. Announcement claims that, this is interesting, the wedding was conducted in complete accordance with the traditional Nair wedding customs. Karyogams, or the Karyogams is a sorority, is a group of this particular community, okay? Both parties were there. And then the next line, which is the penultimate line, Thiruvananthapuram, from that onwards, it's the description of this particular particular togetherness, that Karyogam or that community association or whatever you can call. Very strange, actually. Both their names and all are given. And the last one line, there was also a brief mention about the reception and the girl's makeup artist, Renju Renjimar, whose name in fact stands out because of the absence of a Nair to it. Okay, this is an interpretation, or this is one translation done by one of the journalists who actually took it and did a critical discourse analysis on it. I just copied a few bits from there, especially the last sentence, I just took it. So who is this Renju Renjimar? Anybody has any idea? Very famous person. You can browse and find out who is that person. Okay, so there is a lot of problems here. Why should this marriage, that is supposed to be something like a very personal affair, be advertised with a tag as advertisement? First of all, then why so much of assertion on the caste, and why so much of assertion on the tradition there, and why these particular community organizations called Karyogams are brought into the picture? Why the great generations? Sorry, you're saying something to me?
I'm telling you, Renju Renjimar is like transgender makeup artist.
Yes. Renju Renjimar is a transgender makeup artist, and then by bringing that person in, they are making a different aspect or different shade, they're giving a different shade to the entire narrative. Don't you think so? You think about it. There are so many things to discuss on this, but then I have to move quick, but this is very interesting a piece for critical discourse analysis. When you look at the caste question, when you look at the institution called marriage, it's very significant that we get this kind of an analysis done, because here what happens is my next point, recontextualization, delocation of a practice from its original context and its relocation within another. So somebody is taking a particular context, a particular practice from a particular context and placing it in an extremely different context or maybe slightly different kind of context. It's a relocation that is happening, and this recontextualization is what happens here. And recontextualization is one part of one aspect of critical discourse analysis. Okay, now the examples: political practice to media practice. Some media, now I don't know which media I shouldn't point at, but you think about your own context. Okay, I'm at present in Tamil Nadu. So if I think about the Tamil Nadu politics and the channels, and if I think about the Tamil Nadu history, it's a totally, a puzzling kind of affair. And similarly, you all have your own political history for the place that you come from. Think about it and see how this political practice has been taken from there. You know, politics is a realm, okay? It's a geography in itself. And from there you take it, and not you, there it is taken and placed within another context, which is called journalism, which is called media. You think about it, media being the spokespersons for a particular political party. So there is a recontextualization that is happening there. And because of this, what happens? Have you thought about it? One person who sees a particular channel gets subscribed to one particular ideology. Do you get my point? I hope it's clear. The next one is even easier. There was a class going on in one of the places, one of the universities that I worked at. And then suddenly somebody came, the PRO of the institute came, and he said, "Madam, I need to pick some students up." I said, "You want to pick some students up? Why?" He said, "Some photo shoot is going there for the calendar, so we need some students." And then I knew that there is no point in saying that, you can get them after my class or anything. I just moved aside and they started picking students up. Can you tell me which who would they have picked up? I know you don't know my students, but generally, can you tell me? I gave you enough context.
Good-looking students, ma'am.
Good-looking? Fairer ones? Very good. Prashant? Very good. Fairer one? Well-dressed one? Good-looking ones? Largely females.
And also the one who gets top in the class or ranking.
Top in the class? No, PRO doesn't care about top in the class. Fair and attractive females. Yes, that sums it up, Tiesh. Belonging to elite society. Sorry?
Mostly female and belonging to the higher society.
Higher society. Higher society, okay, how they read it, I have no idea, because maybe they'll read their elitism by looking at them, by seeing their face and appearance and all, and you never know where they come from. That is secondary. A good communicative skill is absolutely not necessary, because they'll be just standing and posing for the picture. They don't need any communication skills at all. And you won't believe, the first girl to be, no, Khalid, multilingual, no. It's just like they need it for the calendar picture. They don't have to speak anything. They just have to be there, beautiful, stand there with their books or computer or whatever. That's it. That's the end of the story. They don't need anything else to that. So what happened was that actually they took one girl, or they selected one girl who was not at all performing in the class at all. Like she's always sleepy in the class, and she was more than happy to go out. And I was even more happy to send her out, because, a sleepy face in my classroom was too much to handle. So this is how. And then the interesting factor is that then they came back after half an hour. I had a 2-hour session. After half an hour, they came back and they started picking up students who are a little dark in complexion and largely male students. And I was like so surprised to see this happening. Okay. And then I understood the entire discourse. So if I ask you to write about the discourse, I'm sure that all of you got the discourse. It's about the discourse of inclusivity. And what is this for? This is for the calendar and this is for the brochure. So the educational institution wants to show that This is where we actually have inclusivity. And then, you know, you can see the recontextualization that is happening there. Education to kind of marketing. We have inclusive kind of a campus. Send your children here. This is what the university brochures or the calendars are actually speaking. Think about it. Now, we have started with the last one actually, because the previous one was leading me here. The matrimonial advertisements. It's taking a private affair to the public domain. Okay, marriage, wedding, these are all private kind of affairs, and it's being taken to the public, and then social to political. So look at the previous one. You know, I could see one comment over there about the community being mentioned and all. Yes, it's political in that sense. You know, we are talking about caste politics there, aren't we? And in a country like India, where honor killing is quite like okay for many of, sadly for many of them, then these have the potential actually. These have great potential of discussing things. Yeah, I have to move to the next slide. I can see the clock ticking by. Now, what is the logic of this recontextualization? The purpose or goal pursued by social agents is part of their plan of action. Whose agenda is this? Who is making this agenda? Think about it. One example is movies being remade into different languages. Why do movies get remade into different languages? It's not just about the economic success of it. Sometimes it's about the ideology being portrayed as well. It's a very interesting kind of a concept. Of course, the money part is very significant. One movie became such a big blockbuster in one particular language. And then think about the movie called Roja. Many of us might know that, even though some of you might be the new generation ones, you might know about this film called Roja or Bombay. Think about the ideology that these movies are actually projecting, and why is it getting such a wide kind of acceptability in different languages? So whose agency is actually mediating there? You need to think about it. Now, communicative purposes, political goals. Sometimes, you know, to project a political ideology, it's being converted into something. Translations happen to project political ideologies. Think about the pamphlets. Okay, think of that is where I said, Khalid, I'll come back to that. The pamphlets, especially in the communist Kerala, I would say that these pamphlets were doing a lot of things. You know, it made the theory, the Marxian communist ideology, very simple, and then it got translated into simple Malayalam, and it was pasted everywhere, and people could read and understand. And then think about street plays. Street plays are also another medium of getting this ideological appropriation through recontextualization. You take something and you place it in a new context, and then there is ideological appropriation happening. Now you need to place this in the framework of ideology. So representation of the world which contribute to establishing, maintaining or changing social relations of power or domination. Can you please mute yourself, because I can hear myself back. Ideological representations are most effective in reinforcing a certain distribution of power relations when they appear to those involved to be common sense or naturalized. This is the problem with this ideological appropriation. I have an ideology. I project it so smartly through language, and when you consume it, I'm actually writing against you. But you don't think that way, because my language use is so wonderful that you think that, okay, this is quite like that, this is quite naturalized, this is common sense. I'll give you an example in a very different context. Now people are very sensitive towards body shaming, slut shaming and all those things. I agree, but there was a time, go back to 90s, if anybody's of my age, go back to 90s or 80s, sometimes like that, or just go and watch those films. You won't be able to enjoy that. I'm not mentioning the books, but I'm telling you about the films that are produced in India, in Bollywood or in Tollywood, Collywood, wherever. Okay, so these films had one superhero character, not superhero, one hero, and there will be generally a person who is a little disfigured kind of a person, or who may be like a joker. I'm not talking about a very good looking kind of secondary character. Or if there is a good looking kind of friend for the hero, there will be somebody who is actually, you know, maybe having Bugs Bunny teeth, or dark in his complexion, something like that, or a little lame, maybe blind. Some physical peculiarity might be given to that person, and then they will be portrayed as a totally stupid kind of person. And then the laughter in the theater. So jokes are implanted into the mouth of these characters. There will be quite a lot of shaming going on, and people laugh in the theater. When we laugh like that, have we ever thought of a person with similar kind of physique sitting along with us in the dark theater, not able to laugh at himself? Or does he or she laugh? Can we think about it? That's what I said. Ideological representations are most effectively trafficked through language by reinforcing those ideologies, actually making people feel that or subscribe to it as common sense, or taking it as naturalized. Okay. And dominance of a particular ideology marks its imprints in the cultural and social artifacts. It is there is nothing to explain it. You can think about your own, you know, political ideology being reflected in films, education, literary texts, books being changed because of certain ideology being projected. There are so many examples around us. Okay. Now, I'm going to wind it up. I started a little late, so I'm taking 5 minutes extra. So CDA in translation, if you look at it, I'm just taking you back to the initial diagram that I showed you. There is a three-stage method of discourse analysis, which includes description of the text, which is like lexical, grammatical orientation, interpretation of the relationship between the discursive processes and the text, the production and the text, the existence of the text, an explanation of the relationship between the discursive processes and the social processes. Now, CDA tries to analyze the translated text accurately to see how much of the original author's ideology is visible in the translation and to what extent cultural values affect this process. So I told you, this is about translation studies. Okay. Now, identifying discourse to discover ideology as a crucial element for translators to have a proper translation and to convey the proper message that the original text intends to give. When you are actually doing a translation, you will definitely read the source text so many times. You need to really read it with the lens of a critical discourse analyst. Identify, is it deceiving? Is this what the person actually wants to say? Especially the vocabulary level, the lexical level, there is a lot of trick that is inherent in many of the writers. And the masters, they are the worst your job will be. It's very difficult to decode what they actually intend. Now, translations can be actually a translator's protest and resistance to the established ideology as well. You look at various pamphlets from your language, or maybe some novels from your own cultural context, or translations, largely translations. Sometimes the translator actually interpolate things. Translator actually puts in his or her own ideology into this translated text, which might not be there in the initial thing. So this kind of a resistance might not have been an intention of the original author at all. The original author may not have such an idea at all, but then this is a practice that the translator does in order to actually mark his or her resistance or revolt towards the system. The target text might have different general pragmatic, communicative and political purpose in the new context. So you are recontextualizing it. When you are translating it with a different ideology, you are actually recontextualizing it. Uninspired or mistranslations, we always talk about them. So sometimes we have to doubt that these could be the results of political and ideological constraints in which translations were produced and received. So there were certain things that somebody could say at one point. Therefore, only that much is shown. The rest of the things are not pretty clear in the translation. So uninspired or mistranslations can be the results of political and ideological constraints within the context of its production. This is also a possibility in translation. So what I would like to highlight here is that read, reread, and reread the source text. Understand and then investigate further. Be a researcher when you are translating a text. It will take time, but be a researcher when you are translating a text and go through it in an in-depth manner and find out what kind of a social, political, and cultural milieu in which this is situated and what kind of an ideology. You need to actually read about the person as well, because sometimes the ideology changes. Sometimes they change their theories. Sometimes they become, many of the communists or Naxalites in Kerala, now they are into the path of devotion and spirituality and all. Their theories change. You can't read their present writing in the same light as they wrote, 30 or 40 years back. It's not possible. So similarly, you need to understand whether recontextualization of ideology has happened or not. Therefore, when you are writing something, when you are doing a translation, research enough about the ideology of the author, research enough about the possibility of the text being recontextualized, and you analyze your own translations. And this is how, for me, I would tell you, this is how when you translate something, of course you get a translation. But if you get your critical discourse analysis lens on, or that switch on, you will get a beautiful paper to be published as well. Because you are doing that job of a translation studies expert, or you are doing that researcher's part of it, which will only make your translation better and perhaps more faithful. So I would like to conclude with that. Thank you very much.